Hello friends, welcome back to the tetrahedron chemistry classes. So guys, in today's class I am going to take very important aspect, right, related to the water chemistry. And today we will see how we can determine the alkalinity of the given water sample, right, which is alkaline in nature. And we'll see the detailed principle and the reactions involved. And at the end of the lecture I will solve the numerical. And this numerical is very, very important for your BTEC first year end semester, or say VTEC first year end semester examination. Okay. So first of all, you can see here alkalinity determination of the water sample. So first of all, we have to define the what is alkalinity. So alkalinity is what? Amount of the acid consumed to neutralize the alkaline water. Okay. And the acid that will that you will use, either you will use sulfuric acid or hydrochloric acid. Since the amount of the alkali present in the water sample, natural water, is actually quite low, or also in the sea industrial effluents, that alkalinity is not that much of high. So we generally use N by 50 H2SO4, okay, or N by 50 HCl. So normality is actually 1 by 50 for this one, right? So I have explained the detailed concept of the normality and all other things. So before going into the detail, you should know what is the normality, how we can actually determine the normality, and how we can prepare the different types of the solutions. If you haven't seen that video on alkalinity and other titration, so here is the link, you can go through the link first. Okay. So this is actually the amount of the acid consumed to neutralize the alkaline water is called the alkalinity of the given water sample. Now there are certain chemicals which are responsible for alkalinity. So I am writing alkalinity causing ions, right? So what are the ions which are present in the alkaline water? They are very common. Mostly, most commonly, this hydroxide, these hydroxide ions are there, which causes the alkalinity, right? And along with the hydroxide ions, you may have your carbonate ions, CO2 negative, and as well as you can have bicarbonate ion, right? These three ions are generally there. See, however, certain other ions may also be present, but in general we have in the water sample these alkalinity causing substances. So how we can prove that these ions causes alkalinity? Because they can consume acids, right? So if you see how I can prove this one, say for example I have this hydroxide ion, it can react with H positive ion to produce H2O. So that means this hydroxide ion is consuming H positive, so that's why it is alkaline in nature, because it is consuming acid, right? Similarly, if you have say bicarbonate and carbonate ion, later we will see with the help of the reactions also, they can also consume the H positive ions provided by these acids, right? So they can cause your alkalinity. Now a very important point here, we may have the different kinds of the alkalinity present in the water sample. Say five situations I can have. See, your water may have only this bicarbonate ions, this can give hardness, right? Or see, hydroxides can be present alone, they can also, it can also provide hardness, alkalinity. Number three, then you may have bicarbonate ion in the water sample, it is 1 negative, not 2 negative, very sorry, it is 1 negative, okay. And number 4, you may have say a combination of carbonate ion plus hydroxide ion. And number 5, you may have the combination of carbonate ion plus bicarbonate ion, right? Only these five possibility can exist to impart alkalinity in the water sample. One condition we can very easily remove from here, say what left, say I have my bicarbonate ion, okay, along with my hydroxide ion. Say this is the combination which I have which I haven't written over there. Why I haven't written this combination there? because whenever we have these two simultaneously, it will give you the carbonate ion and the water molecule. So these two cannot actually remain together in the water sample. And this is a very famous and very important question which examiner generally asked in during your viva voice. If you have given these substances or these ions, which combination is not possible? So this combination is not possible. It is very, very important to note that. Okay, so we'll nullify this one. So we can focus on these ones. So how we can determine the alkalinity of the given water sample? Say, for example, you have given some alkaline water. So I'm writing here alkaline water sample. This sample is given to you, right? Generally, you see this water sample is having pH greater than 8.3 due to the presence of the hydroxide ion or the other ions. It is having this one. Okay, now this is the alkaline water. What you do, you add an indicator, right? So the indicator used in this titration, see, whenever you have the pH greater than 8.3, right, which is generally there, so you will start your titration with the indicator called phenolphthalein. Phenolphthalein. Okay, so the moment you add phenolphthalein in the solution, then you will get the pink color. Okay, you will get the pink color. And whenever you get the pink color, that pH which was earlier greater than actually 8.3, it is lowered up to 8.3, right? So the solution, the alkaline water, will have now the pH of this one. So again, you can see this pink color, you can see in alkaline water, right? Alkaline water. This is how you can see. Now up to this point, what actually reactions occurs here? You can see up to this point, what are the possible reactions? For example, say I am getting this particular one. So later on I will explain the reaction how it goes. Now you will titrate this pink color solution. You will titrate this pink color solution with N by 50 acid. Okay, now you will start doing titration, and what will happen at the end point, this pink color disappears and you will have the colorless solution. Colorless solution. So what reactions actually happen during this period? Those reactions are pretty much important. See, your water sample was earlier having hydroxide ion and you have added H positive ion. Okay, then they have converted into water. Similarly, your water sample earlier was also having carbonate ion. If they are having the carbonate ion, then it will react with the H positive and it will form bicarbonate ion. Okay, this is your bicarbonate ion. So up to this point, say, whatever the amount of the acid used here, you will note that acid used as, say, I am writing here acid used AML. This is very, very important, right? And this is also known as the phenolphthalein alkalinity. Up to this point, this indicates phenolphthalein alkalinity. Okay, this is something very, very important. Now you can see I am demonstrating this experiment with the see in my lab, so you can focus on this particular step up to this particular point where we will get the colorless solution, right? Okay guys, now we will demonstrate determination of alkalinity in the given water sample, and for this experiment you will need these reagents. First, you see, you will need this N by 50 H2SO4, which is a standard solution, and you know the standard solution would go in the
burette, right? So we have already filled that burette with that N/50 H2SO4, and then of course you will require your sample water. So we have already made the alkaline water to conduct the experiment, right? So this is your sample water, and these are the two indicators. First is the phenolphthalein, and second is the methyl orange. Okay, so we will start that reaction, and we have already taken with the help of the pipette 25 ml of the alkaline water, right? You can see here there is no color in the alkaline water right now. Now we will start that reaction. Okay, now we will add the phenolphthalein indicator, 2 drops of phenolphthalein to it. Okay, we have added little more, but no need to worry because we have to visualize the color change actually, right? So you can see this is the pink color which we obtained after mixing that phenolphthalein indicator into the water solution. You know in the alkaline solution your phenolphthalein is actually pink in color. Now we will titrate this pink color solution with the help of the EDTA solution, sorry, with the help of the N/50 H2SO4. Okay. So you can see we are titrating this. Okay, shake the reaction mixture. Okay, stop. Right, you can see this is the colorless solution right now. So this endpoint you can note down as the phenolphthalein endpoint. Okay, now to this same colorless solution, what I will do, I will add my next indicator, and my next indicator is methyl orange, right? So the moment I add methyl orange, 2 drops of the methyl orange to the solution, then I'll get the yellow color solution. Yellow solution, okay? But my medium is still alkaline, remember? My medium is still alkaline. Why I am calling it? Because you may have the several questions from in your Viva voice, right? See, what is the color of the phenolphthalein in alkaline medium? It is pink in color, right? When pH is gray, when pH is 8.3, right? And it is actually the colorless when the neutral medium is there. After that, you can see here, when you add the methyl orange in the alkaline medium, you may see you have the yellow color solution of that methyl orange in the alkaline solution. Okay, so why this is alkaline? Because still you can see the solution is still having what? That bicarbonate ion, which vanilla we obtained in the first step, it is still there. That's why it is alkaline in nature. Okay, now again what you will do, you will titrate this solution again N/50 acid, and at the end point what you will get, you will get red color. Okay, you will get red color, and this is your end point red color. And why this red color appears here? Because your bicarbonate ion, which was present earlier there, okay, it reacts with your H positive ion. Bicarbonate ion reacts with the H positive, and it will give you water and carbon dioxide. Now your system, your media, your solution is neutral. So I can write neutral here. Okay, and up to this point you can see here whatever the amount of the acid used here, we'll call it as acid used as BML. This you have to keep in mind. Okay, these are the reactions involved. Now again you can see I am demonstrating that particular step so that you have a very clear idea about how the color change occurs. So you can observe this. The same solution, we will add 2 drops of methyl orange indicator, only 2 drops. Fine. If you shake this reaction mixture, it would be yellow in color. Right, you can see this is the yellow color.
state karo, theek. Okay, fine. This is yellow color. Now we will continue this titration to get the red color, and we'll report that consumption of H2SO4 as methyl orange endpoint. Okay, continue titration. So guys, you can see here we are adding drop wise, and this is the correct way of performing any titration. You will always add your titrant drop wise with continuous shaking. However, this removal or see this dipping down of the drop is quite slow. So once you get the first reading, you can actually run faster that titrant. But initially, if you are doing for the first reading, then it must be performed very slowly, just like that. Okay. So at the end point, this yellow color would turn into the reddish one. Stop. Now guys, you can see this color is actually now changed from yellow to little red. So this is the end point. This is your methyl orange end point, and you will report that reading from the burette. You can see I have already told you how to actually visualize the exact meniscus. So it is 4.3. So this is your second reading. So this is how we can perform the alkalinity determination experiment.
Okay, now I will discuss the different reactions involved in the titration, right? So first of all, I am explaining the phenolphthalein reaction with the acid and how the color change occurs. It is very important. So for this, first of all, you have to have clear idea about the structure of the phenolphthalein. So this is, say, your benzene. It is connected with C double bond O here, and this is again carbon, this is oxygen, and just like that, here you are having, say, 1, 2, 3, and OH is here. Similarly, at this point you are also having another ring, okay, and that ring is just like that. Say this is OH. So this is the structure of the phenolphthalein which you should learn actually, right? And this phenolphthalein is colorless in neutral medium as well as in the acid medium. Okay, so you should note this particular point. It is colorless, okay, in acidic medium or in neutral medium. Fine. Now what I will do, say I'm adding hydroxide to it, because I have added, you can see here, I have added that phenolphthalein in the alkaline water. That means my water is having already having the alkalinity. So first of all, I am reacting this it with hydroxide ion, right? If we have the all these ions present in the solution, so this hydroxide ion is very strong base, so it will react first preferentially over this bicarbonate and carbonate ion. They will not react, but your hydroxide ion would react. So I'll take three of this. Okay, so when I'll take the three of this, then I'll have this particular structure. I can show you, say for example, this is the benzene ring, and this is COO negative, because this particular bond would break from here to here. Okay, see, this is the ester, and when ester reacts with the alkaline solution, then it will produce acid. Okay, so that's why I have shown this acid, this actually benzoate ion, which is actually comes from the acid. Fine. And then you can see here, one carbon is here, and you are having this structure, and this would be O negative, because one of the hydrogen would be consumed with that one hydroxide ion, so this will have the negative over there. And similarly, you can see this is also having O negative. Okay, this is how you can write. So this actually is pink in color. This particular structure is pink in color. So how the pink color appears here, and how we can explain the formation of the pink color. So you know the Benzonate theory and the Cununate theory of the color formation. So I am quickly explaining the resonance structures of this one. Say this would come down, so it would be double now, and this bond would come here, and this would go there. Okay, then of course you will have your resonance structure. So I can draw the resonance structure for these. So how I can draw very quickly. So this was COO negative, this is carbon. Now this would become double because one bond have shifted here, and now this has shifted here, so this will double, this will double, and this is O negative. So this is the cuninoid system. And again you can see, okay, just like that, O negative. Fine. So this structure is again the resonance stabilized structure. How you can see, you can draw one more resonance structure for this one. This can come here, okay, and this can come here, okay, and this can go there, and this will go up, this will go up, and this will go up. When this happens, you will have your another resonance structure, and that resonance structure would be just like that. You can see here, this part, this is COO negative, this is carbon. Now this one would become double, just like that, the cununate system. This is double bond oxygen, this is the carbon, and you can see here, this would be now O negative. So you can see very easily, you can see here, this particular system, right, from here to here, these two rings which were having actually the OH group, they are involved in the resonance stabilization. And you can see that the greater delocalization of electron is taking place. And if you recall my UV spectroscopy, where the conjugation occurs, then such system actually absorbs color and certain radiation. After absorption of the color, certain radiation they emit, and that emitted radiation would be appeared. So by this phenomenon, this particular phenolphthalein shows the pink color. Okay, so this is the reaction which is responsible to give that pink color solution, right? This is very, very important for you, practical as well as for your examination point of view. Okay, now I'll explain the next reaction, which is see, now you'll get the colorless solution. After you see, you have pink this one, and when you have titrated, you'll get the colorless solution. And after that, you are adding methyl orange and you are getting the yellow color solution. And after complete titration, you are getting actually the red color solution. So what are the reactions involved in that case? So these reactions, again, I am explaining. Now you can see my reactions for methyl orange. So I am writing methyl orange reactions, very important. Now this is the structure of the methyl orange which you keep in mind. Okay, this is double bond oxygen, nitrogen, double bond nitrogen, right, just like that. This is double bond nitrogen with two methyl attached here. Okay, and this is your actually acid part. So this is the methyl orange. So how the reaction goes? So what you can do, you can add, or you have hydroxide ions present in it. Okay, so these hydroxide, you can see this is the acid, this is base, so water molecule will remove from that particular position, and then you will have your ionized form, right? And then you will have SO3 negative, which is this one. This benzene ring I am not touching. This is actually your nitrogen, double bond nitrogen, okay? And this benzene ring I am writing to show the bond, because I have to delocalize the electrons. The lone pair is already there on the nitrogen. You should know lone pairs are always there on the nitrogens, okay? One lone pair, and these are the two methyls attached to this one, okay? So now what you can see here, the moment you add acid to the solution, right, H positive, all reactions are reversible. So where actually this H positive would go? So see, this H positive cannot go there because it will ionize to give the H positive again. So it will attach one of the nitrogen atom. So how it will attach on the nitrogen atom, you can see electronic movement. This lone pair would come here, okay? This would become double. So this will come here and this double bond will go there. This would be double, right? And this pair have to shift at this particular point so that the electron density is there. Extra electron density is coming here, and this electron density actually will grab this proton, okay? When it will grab this particular proton, then you will have this system, benzene, okay, SO3 negative, this is NH, this is single bond, nitrogen with lone pair, it is double now, okay, this is double now, this nitrogen, and you will have, see, this bond is here, this has moved here, and this have came down, and then again this is double and positive over there, right? Because it has lost an electron pair. So this is how you can write whenever you react with this particular one, okay? So this form is actually what? Red color. This is the end point. This is the end point. So these reactions are very, very important. This was actually, you can see it is colorless in that. See, it is yellow in color in that manner. Again, see, if you change, see, it is colorless in that case, right? When you add in the little alkaline medium. And after that, you can see this particular form, it is orange in color. Not orange, actually, it appears yellow in color, okay? And after yellow, when you react with this with acid, that means the titration, during titration, okay, then you will get this particular guy. So these are the reactions which are very, very important, which you need to understand. And then the final concept here, the calculations and how we can solve the numerical based on this, okay? These numericals are very, very important. So you know, whenever we do the titration, we have only one principle, that is law of milliequivalents, N1 V1 equals to N2 V2. Very, very important, okay? See, this I have already told you in one of my earlier lecture. I am giving you the link in the description where you can go through the lectures and learn the concepts, okay? So this, say this is for sample, that means the alkaline water, and this is for standard acid, and you have to find the normality of the sample, so you will calculate N1. So for example, you can see N1 you are calculating, that would be equals to normality of this is given 1/50. As I already told you, the solutions, actually the alkaline solutions are pretty much dilute, so we generally use the N/50 solution. So in that case, the strength of the sulfuric acid is given N/50, okay? And this is actually your V2, and since I am doing for the first, you have done with the alkaline phenolphthalein alkalinity, so I'll use that AML here, okay? So that V2, that means the acid consumed for phenolphthalein endpoint. Phenolphthalein and point, right? I am doing for this one. So V2 was here A, and this V1 would come here, 1 upon V1. Okay, so this is the normality of the alkaline solution. And as you know, whenever you do such experiment, you have to calculate the alkalinity or the hardness in terms of the calcium carbonate equivalent. So I'll determine the strength of alkaline water in terms of CaCO3, calcium carbonate equivalent. Okay, so that would be equal to what? 1 by 50 into A into 1 by V1 from this expression. And I already told you, whenever you want to convert normality into the strength in the gram per liter, so you have to multiply the entire equation or right hand side part of the equation with the equivalent weight of the species. So we are actually calculating in with respect to the calcium carbonate. So we have to multiply that particular factor with the equivalent weight of calcium carbonate, and that is 50. The moment you multiply this it with 50, it will become the strength in the gram per liter. Okay, and you know, we generally express such reports in the milligram per liter. So what I can do here, 1 by 50 into A into 1 upon V1 into 50 into 1000. I can write 1000 here. So that would be in the milligram per liter. So what remains here? 50 and 50 would cancel each other. Then you will have A into 1 upon V1 into 1000 ppm. This is phenolphthalein alkalinity. And remember, this V1 is what? This is the volume of the sample given. Volume of the sample given. You can see here V1. Okay. Now, we can calculate for the total alkalinity. So, methyl orange. Or you can say the total alkalinity. Total alkalinity. So again, this is very, very simple. You can see here, once you have titrated with the phenolphthalein, and after that you have titrated with the methyl orange, and in that case the acid used is the BML. That means you are adding additional BML, as you have seen in the demonstration of the experiment also, where I have said that we will add that methyl orange to the same solution, same colorless solution. That means extra BML we are adding. So we are adding extra BML. Now the equation becomes quite simple here, right? A was already there, and we are adding extra B, A plus B into 1 upon V1 into 1000, and that would be your methyl orange alkalinity. Right now, in case if you are interested in only in the hydroxide, now see this methyl orange and total alkalinity, you know it is due to the presence of the your carbonate as well as your hydroxide, these two, right? But so far you have calculated this total, and this total is actually due to the here I have written where, okay, this you have calculated due to this combination, right? Carbonate and the hydroxide, and after that you have converted into bicarbonate. But since if you are interested only in the hydroxide ion, so you can calculate say hydroxide alkalinity, right? So if you see these reactions, guys, if you see these reactions here, what happens actually? Hydroxide reacts with the acid to produce water. And if you are interested only in this one, that means you will need only your AML, and there would be no addition of the extra BML. So how I can write for this particular one, hydroxide alkalinity? So that would be equals to A which is phenolphthalein endpoint, minus B, and that would not be there, and rest will remain same into 1000 ppm. Very important. Okay, and similarly, if you want to calculate for carbonate alkalinity, right, carbonate alkalinity, so what you will do, see, you will check the, you will check your phenolphthalein endpoint as well as your methyl orange endpoint. You know phenolphthalein endpoint was your A and methyl orange endpoint was B, right? If your, say, the amount of the acid consumed in the phenolphthalein endpoint is greater, then you will remember this particular trick, then carbonate alkalinity would be equals to 2B into, rest will remain same, V1 into 1000 ppm. Okay, now if this happens, your amount of amount of acid consumed during phenolphthalein endpoint is less than or equal to B, then carbonate alkalinity would be calculated by 2A into 1 upon V1 into 1000 ppm. Okay, and similarly, say here you have added this particular one. If you want to calculate for only bicarbonate alkalinity, that means B minus A into 1 upon V1 into 1000 ppm. So these are the formula which you will keep in mind. Okay, so this is the formula for your bicarbonate alkalinity, right? And now you are having formulas which can be used to identify the different kinds of the alkalinity present in the water sample. Okay, so as you can see here, in case of the bicarbonate ion, B minus A is the formula, because in that case A, you know, A is the phenolphthalein endpoint, this would be zero, because you know whenever you have that methyl orange and this phenolphthalein endpoint, then you must have hydroxide ion as well as carbonate ion in your sample. Whenever you are not having the hydroxide and the carbonate ion in the sample, then A would be zero. Okay, so this is the formula. So these formula you will always keep in mind before solving the numerical based on this. Okay, now I'll discuss the numerical which has been asked in the previous semester examination of your BTech first year, right? You can see this particular table, which is very, very important, and my advice is that you should actually learn this particular table before solving the numerical. Okay, and this is the summarization, how it goes actually. So in the first column you can see the titrations results, whatever the results you will have, I have summarized here, and then these are the different ions which are responsible for producing alkalinity in the water sample, right? Say if, for example, if A equals to 0, you know A is actually your phenolphthalein endpoint. When A equals to 0, then there is no question of these ions, right? Hydroxide and carbonate ion. As just earlier I told you, whenever A equals to 0, that means there is no phenolphthalein endpoint, then hydroxide and carbonate would not be there. Only carbonate would be there, bicarbonate would be there, and that bicarbonate actually, B is what? Your methyl orange endpoint. So that B will correspond to the total alkalinity, and that will give you the bicarbonate hardness. Okay, but if A equals to B, for example, say you are having, say you are consuming 15 ml for phenolphthalein endpoint and 15 ml for your methyl orange endpoint, and if both are same, then both can be actually equal to the hydroxide concentration. That means only this particular ion is responsible for the alkalinity, while your carbonate and bicarbonate would be absent if this happens, right? And in the next point you can see, if A equals to half of B, that means V1 equals to V2, right? So whether it is up to you whether you remember this particular point or this particular point, right? So it is better to remember in terms of this A and half B. When this happens, actually the value of A actually is the half of the B, then there is no question of your hydroxide ion, right? Only you will have the carbonate ion present in this particular stage. Why? Because carbonate ion would be converted into the bicarbonate ion by the consumption of your consumption of your acid to give this A, right? But in that, when this happens actually, then there is no hydroxide, only carbonates would be present, right? And you know the carbonate first will go into the bicarbonate, and bicarbonate then utilize to form carbon dioxide and the water. That's why 2A is written here, because you will use double the volume of the sulfuric acid for this, right? In that case, you have only this, you will have only this carbonate hardness, while hydroxide and bicarbonate would be absent. Similarly, you can see here, if A is greater than half of B, right, then your hydroxide and carbonate both would be present, okay, and your bicarbonate would not be there. So what is the meaning of 2A minus B? It simply implies that you multiply the volume of the H2SO4 used for phenolphthalein endpoint by 2, and then you subtract the value of methyl orange endpoint from that, and whatever the volume would come, that particular volume of acid actually is used to neutralize this hydroxide ions, right? These hydroxide ions, okay? Or alternatively, you can see 2B minus 2A. If similarly, you can understand this particular point to calculate the carbonate hardness, carbonate alkalinity. But if the reverse happens, actually A is less than the half of the B, then your hydroxide would not be present and your sample would contain the carbonate and the bicarbonate. And this is just the simple explanation which is given in the Shashi Chawla book. You can go through that particular book to understand the things actually. Now, guys, you can simply focus on this particular numerical, and the numerical is just like that. This is one of the previous semester question actually, right? A 100 ml water sample required 25 ml of 0.05 NH2SO4 for phenolphthalein endpoint, okay? And that means if it is phenolphthalein endpoint, that means this 25 ml is actually what? Your A. This is your phenolphthalein alkalinity. That means this much of sulfuric acid would correspond to the phenolphthalein endpoint. And another 10 ml, right? Another 10 ml you are adding for the methyl orange endpoint, right? Determine the nature and the amount of the alkalinity. So again, see, you can see whenever you do any kind of the titration, the only principle involved in this, what? Law of milliequivalents. So what you can do, you can write N1 V1 equals to N2 V2, right? And if you are doing this, say this is for your sample, I am writing here, and this is for your, say, standard, okay? That means acid. So you have to calculate the normality of that standard. So what you will have, N1 equals to 1 upon V1 into N2 into V2. Up to this particular point, there is no problem, right? And this is the volume of the sample taken, and volume of the sample taken is 100 ml. So straightforward, what you can write 1 upon 100 here. And this N2 is the normality of the acid use, and normality of the acid used is 0.05 N. So you will write 0.05 here. Okay, there is no problem in that. And then you are having the V2. V2 is what actually? Your AML, right? The standard, this particular one, 25 ml. So to avoid the confusion, I am writing A as such. Now later on I will put the value here. Why I am doing this one? Because whatever I have explained previously, I have explained you all the things in that particular manner only. So I don't want to create unnecessary confusion to you. That's why I am doing the same thing. But if you have some other idea, then you can do, or you can solve the problems by your own also. So this is actually the way. Now say this, you have to see, this is the normality. Now, if you convert that normality into gram per liter, okay, and in terms of the calcium carbonate, right? So you will multiply that with 50. 50 is the equivalent weight of the calcium carbonate, right? And this is how you can do, right? So this you can write in gram per liter, and that would be in terms of CaCu3. I already told you in the hardness experiment and in the alkalinity experiment, it is necessary to convert the alkalinity causing and the hardness causing substances into the calcium carbonate equivalent. It is taken as the standard actually. Okay, then again, if you want to convert into the milligram per liter or say parts per million, so this would be 0.05, this would be A, this would be 50, this is 1000, that would be milligram per liter or simply parts per million. So if you solve this particular one, right, so what you will have here, 100 and 100, there is no problem in that. So you will have 0.05 into A, right, into 500. Okay, and then if you multiply this one, that would be 25.00 into A. So that would be your phenolphthalein alkalinity. So what would be the phenolphthalein alkalinity? 25 into, what is the value of the A? A you have taken here, it is 25, so this will give you 625. So this is 625 milligram per liter, which is actually the phenolphthalein alkalinity. Okay, now if you go for your methyl orange alkalinity, so this I have solved for phenolphthalein. Okay, phenolphthalein, okay, because I have taken B here. Now if you want to calculate the methyl orange, methyl orange alkalinity, so I already told you for methyl orange what you will do, you will see this particular formula, you will do 25 into A plus B, right? This is the formula which we have earlier derived. Where is the formula? So right now I am not having that particular formula, but you can remember in that manner I have already told you. Okay, so this is A plus B, and if you do 25 into, what was A? A was 25, and you have added another 10 ml, that is plus 10. So this is actually your 25 into 35, right? And 25 into 35, that will 55 is 25. Okay, and then 52 is 10, 17. So this would be somewhere around 875 ppm. So this is your methyl orange. So this was the question actually, amount of the alkalinity present in the water. Now you have to decide the nature. So nature in that case, you can see here whether the alkalinity is due to the hydroxide ion, carbonate ion or bicarbonate ion. For this you will take the help of this particular table. Okay, so in that case A is not 0 because A is 25, and another A is not equal to B because A is 25 and B is 10, so this does not hold. And A equals to half of B, no, it is not like that. A is 25, right, and if you do the half of B, so it is not equal to, just like the, it is not equal to like that. And then you are having A is greater, see this condition can hold, A is greater than half of B, so you can we can check this one, A is greater than half of B, whether it is holding or not. So your A is actually, you can see it was 25, right, and this is 10 by 2, that is 5, that means 25 is greater than 5. Okay, this holds actually, A is greater than half of B. And when this happens, A is greater than the half of B, that means your sample is having the hydroxide ion as well as the carbonate ion, but there is no presence of the bicarbonate ion. So here you can write the alkalinity is due to the hydroxide ion as well as due to the carbonate ion. So this is the nature of the alkalinity. This is how you can solve the numerical based on the alkalinity experiment. So if you go through the Sashi Chawla book, you will find the different varieties of the numerical. And see why I have solved this particular numerical, because see in UTU BTech first year examination, This particular question has been asked several times. See, whatever the numerical they asked previously, they have asked from this particular topic, they actually went with this type of the numerical. Only the data they have changed, but the nature remains same. But it is not like that, it will happen always again and again. So you have to actually practice the another numericals also from the Shashi Chawla book. The important thing is that you will keep in mind this particular concept. And earlier, see, in the earlier part of the video, I have explained how to calculate alkalinity, right? So guys, you may have a 5 marker question from this particular topic or a 10 marker question from this particular topic in your end semester examination. So prepare this particular topic, and very soon I'll make a video on the hardness determination with the help of the EDTA, and that would also be very, very helpful for you for your end semester examination. And in your examination, either this alkalinity one or next your EDTA experiment, either of the two actually will definitely right, see whether this one or the hardness one, it will definitely come in your end semester examination, and the value of the question would be somewhere around 5 to 10 marks. Okay, so that's it for today. And before signing out, I am requesting you again, please subscribe the Titrant in chemistry classes, and don't forget to hit the bell icon for the latest notification. Thank you very much. Thank you.